better individual players at the moment, like Sven above Freeze and Perks above Ryu and so on.
We'll see if that actually does play into it right here as we head into a champion select here, HGK versus G2. And the first ban is going to be aimed at the mid lane. Perks going to be taking away his Azir and his Ryze. And Draven ban, as per usual, Freeze busts it out early on to a split. Then for the rest of time, it's taken away from him and no one ever lets him play the pick again.
But it's a tough situation. I was debating with myself, do you ban Draven against Freeze every time? Because you don't actually know if you want to play it one more time. It could be just specifically against Fnatic. They had prepared this with the compositions. That's why they wanted to play it. Now G2 plays it safe. But I do think if you are G2 and you really are confident in your own ability, just removing comfort picks and certain picks you maybe don't play against too often is actually very smart.
Yeah.
Because then let's just say HGK has a new crazy pick ready. Maybe G2 then swaps the Draven ban for that one in the next game. So I think it's perfectly fine.
Yeah, and then he brings out the Draven.
And then he gets the Draven. Yeah. Wow.
Oh, interesting. So we had the final ban of Trundle and the Brahms also taken away from Miffy. First pick actually came out of the Caitlyn, so really high priority on this pick, but I can understand why. Caitlyn has been so strong in recent weeks in terms of like the playstyle and has been like the crux of many compositions. So it really kind of shows what HGK are going for.
We talked about this karma in the last series though, Pulse, about how after it's been used so much over in Korea, it's a fantastic pick. Flex pick, of course, go to two lanes, mid and support. It was banned in both those games. And I'm not surprised to see G2 early pick it here because it is such a power pick in the current meta. Literally gives you a lane that can win against almost anything. And you have so much pressure and roaming potential as well because you are so mobile. I really like the pick. I think it's strong and I think it's fantastic on a guy like Perks, who can really win his lane and is very aggressive in the way he likes to play. If they do put it in the mid lane, obviously it could just be straight to support.
I mean, this composition is already shaping up to be very fast and very fun.
Oh, yes.
Got the Karma and Nidalee starting off, so you can be very aggressive with those picks.
And that's where if you H2K now, you basically see what this G2 is trying to do. Okay, strong laning phase, early aggression from your jungler who can invade in. So
Draven ban, as per usual, Freeze busts it out early on to a split. Then for the rest of time, it's taken away from him and no one ever lets him play the pick again.
But it's a tough situation. I was debating with myself, do you ban Draven against Freeze every time? Because you don't actually know if you want to play it one more time. It could be just specifically against Fnatic. They had prepared this with the compositions. That's why they wanted to play it. Now G2 plays it safe. But I do think if you are G2 and you really are confident in your own ability, just removing comfort picks and certain picks you maybe don't play against too often is actually very smart.
Yeah.
Because then, let's just say HGK has a new crazy pick ready. Maybe G2 then swaps the Draven ban for that one in the next game. So I think it's perfectly fine.
Yeah, and then he brings out the Draven.
And then he gets the Draven. Yeah. Wow.
Oh, interesting. So we had the final ban of Trundle and the Brahms also taken away from Miffy. First pick actually came out of the Caitlyn, so really high priority on this pick, but I can understand why. Caitlyn has been so strong in recent weeks in terms of like the playstyle and has been like the crux of many compositions. So it really kind of shows what HGK are going for.
We talked about this karma in the last series though, Pulse, about how after it's been used so much over in Korea, it's a fantastic pick. Flex pick, of course, go to two lanes, mid and support. It was banned in both those games. And I'm not surprised to see G2 early pick it here because it is such a power pick in the current meta. Literally gives you a lane that can win against almost anything. And you have so much pressure and roaming potential as well because you are so mobile. I really like the pick. I think it's strong and I think it's fantastic on a guy like Perks, who can really win his lane and is very aggressive in the way he likes to play. If they do put it in the mid lane, obviously it could just be straight to support.
I mean, this composition is already shaping up to be very fast and very fun.
Oh, yes.
Got the Karma and Nidalee starting off, so you can be very aggressive with those picks.
And that's where if you H2K now, you basically see what this G2 is trying to do. Okay, strong laning phase, early aggression from your jungler who can invade in. So H2K cannot pick weak lanes. They have to pick lanes that can try and match what G2 is doing to stop this Nidalee from just running all over them.
Yeah.
If they go full late game, say, no, we don't care about anything early game, you have one of these games where it's G2 making mistakes that allows H2K to hit the late game and therefore win the game, and not because H2K played it extremely well. So I like what they're doing because this is a flex pick Gragas who can go top lane. We know how strong he is in the laning phase.
Yeah.
And the Bard Caitlyn is a fantastic 2v2. If you're a good Bard player, he's up there with like Zyra, Nami, Karma as like a strong laning support. If you are not the greatest bot player, have a bad day, however, he can be super useless. So a lot of focus on Vander here.
True, but I feel like if you're going to pick bot in competitive, you're fairly confident that you're a good bot player and you can make it work. And we have seen some really strong bots, absurd amount of damage in the early game, almost always taking Thunderlords. So that has been locked in. And G2, I'm going to pick up the Fizz now coming out, so could flex into the top lane or the mid lane. Even jungle, we've seen that a couple times. Karma could flex into support mid lane, and then we've got the Sivir picked up for G2 as well.
I love it though. I mean, both teams are looking at the same thing. G2 again, picking strong early lanes with the top lane pick for Fizz. While Sivir is not the strongest laner, she can push. When you have Nidalee, it's all about pushing, 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 so the enemy is forced to sit on a tower and defend while your Nidalee is running wild in your jungle and you're under pressure. Also, I think Sivir is obviously a great AD carry when it comes to the mid to late game. Mm-hmm. Ability, yada, yada, yada. We've talked about it for 2 years almost.
Yeah, that's very true.
G2, though, with this 2v2 setup, unless they like lock in a Nami as the support pick, one thing G2 loves to do is last pick support and see, okay, what exactly do we need here against H2K's comp. But if they take like a Nami, they might try and opt into the 2v2 lane if they can outplay Vander and Freeze. Otherwise, you just link swap with this one and say, you know what, don't want to deal with this Kayle into Sivir match.
Could be very difficult to lane against in, of course, standard lanes. But there is all the option for Australia lanes. We've got the Elise pickup with the Victor.
Ah, is that a early game jungler?
Whoa. It's almost like they're trying to match G2.
It's almost like they're saying, G2, we don't want you to just snowball and run away with the game. So yeah, both teams picking up, well, especially on the H2K side, very strong lanes. Gragas top, great early laner. Bard Caitlyn, fantastic 2v2. Victor, overall extremely safe in the mid lane. Question is it going to be Karma support, Aurelia top, Fizz mid, which it would be if they lock in this one, or do they just put the Karma mid? No, they do lock it in. So, again, flex picking is so powerful because you never really know who's going where. Does give G2 a weak mid lane, at least before one or two backs. But it does give them fantastic kill pressure in these skirmishes after level 6.
Yep. Glad to see Aurelia coming back. This is actually the first game of Aurelia I've cast despite Aurelia being picked up so much. Yeah, I know. It's always been on the other stream, just like allowing it. Like, I just want to cast it. But yeah, first time for me. But great to see so many Aurelias being picked up recently. Great carry top laner, buffs to Triforce, of course, or changes to Triforce have benefited Aurelia a lot.
Yeah, definitely a pick we can talk more about in-game as well. Overall compositions, G2 went away from having the super strong early mid laner, and went for scaling and kill pressure. One thing we know, the G2 lineup likes to play around the individual skill.
Yeah.
Like we know the perks on an assassin can win the game for, so therefore we can trust in him to play this Fizz.
Well, you've seen the comps, ladies and gentlemen. You know the squads, and now it's time for H2K and G2 to fight for first place in our match of the week.
So I would say they're the best bot lane now in Europe for sure, and I hope we'll catch up.
Overall, H2K is going to be a stronger team in the long run.
I don't know if they are stronger now, but in the longer run, I'm sure G2 will be stronger, and so will.
We are on to Summoner's Rift between H2K and G2. First game of this best of two here in the studio. And hopefully this game is at least something like the last one, because man, that was a crazy game. Both of these two teams right at the top of the table fighting over that first place.
Yeah, I mean, I liked some of the parts of the last game. It was crazy for sure.
Not the pause.
Definitely not the pause, but also the risky calls, right? The last game had a lot of weird moments, not really that high level. We want to see the high level part and the exciting part mixed together in this match of the week here. G2, H2K, both teams fighting for first place. And it would be fantastic for an H2K team that got criticized after week one and not having the greatest performance to then walk in here, have a great week two, start week three by beating G2 and then taking that first place.
And a lot of that was on the man you can see right there on Caitlyn. Freeze was absolutely going.
Caitlyn is not a man.
No, but Freeze is.
That's true.
Caitlyn is definitely not a man. I can figure that one out. Sometimes it's harder with, like, you know, Rek'Sai, of course, a female, and Kindred, which is a they. But yeah, Freeze went off last week on Draven and Ashe when they were playing the Ashe Syra lane. So this time going towards the Caitlyn. It was actually first picked by H2K. So really setting up the composition from there.
And it makes sense, right? Draven was banned away. The most picked AD carry for both of the guys will be the Caitlyn.
Sure.
Ashe would have been another option, but we know how much value both teams put on having these strong early lanes. That's why also the Nidalee pick comes in for Trick. To use the strong lanes to take over the game. And yeah, as you talked about with this Aurelia top, I mean, the reason she's back, right? Trinity Force buffs were fantastic. Nerfs to other tanks up in the top lane. Rift Herald got changed. She's now more of a split pushing buff. So there's a lot of things really benefiting her. She has a lot of skill matchups. That's what I like about Aurelia right now. If you're really good on her, you can pick her into a lot of different matchups and do well. But you can also get punished. Mithy is not getting punished here. He's instead slapping Oramna on the butt, and then he walks away.
Yeah, I don't know if Karma really slaps people. He kind of throws bolts of like energy at people.
It's a different kind of slap.
Different kind of slap, I see. Still towards the butt. Takes a tower shot,
though. Tower slap as well.
Yeah, tower slap as he walks away. Mid lane, just kind of trading off right now. Of course, usually range matchups do better. Why does Mithy slap? That is a very, very good question as we get into the laning phase here. And Perks is going to put a fear aggression down, gets the Funlord proc as well. But of course, range matchups, not great for Fizz.
No, this is a risky one. So Fizz in their mid lane. Weak early game. Needs level 6. Definitely one or two good backs as well, but he has teleport to get back to lane to try and keep up in farm. And then he needs a jungler around him if he wants to play aggressive. Because the way Fizz can do well in lane, if he can all in, if he can put pressure and say, if you walk too close to me, I will use my ulti and I will force you out of lane or even kill you. But you need your jungler around you or you need pink wards around you. So that's where the Elise pick is really smart from H2K to kind of challenge that in the early game, can challenge the mid lane a bit in the early game in that sense, and actually camp the mid lane if needed.
Yeah.
Making it much harder for Perks to have an easy early game. And therefore, it's just going to be a lane where Rear will push in, Perks will try and maximize his farm, then TP back to lane. He shouldn't lose too many CS, he just might never get like a 1v1 all in.
Sure. By the way, lane swap. So both teams going to take that initial tower. And
I mean, it's an HGK.
We won't have the,
it's
an HGK game, of course. But we won't see those 2v2 lanes. So we're not going to see Sven and Miffy try and hold their own against against Freeze and Banner. For now, maybe they'll go Australia lanes in a bit. But we do have Expect now. Interesting to see how much he can do now. We saw good mechanics from him in that one game he did play.
Yes, definitely.
Because
I mean, that's why they picked him up, right?
Here. Yeah.
Really good
didn't
individual.
Just take him off the streets and was just like, yeah, get on stage and
we don't know
play
you.
Aurelia.
Doesn't matter, sign that guy.
Yeah.
He's called Expect. I mean, yeah. Come on. I mean, it's a cool name.
It is. Well, lots of Koreans do that, though. They go with the one-word name, like Pulse, not Deficio.
I mean, I don't know if Pulse is that impactful of a name. It could
no.
be called, like, Guilfoyle. That would be a sick name.
What?
Guilfoyle.
Okay. I don't know. That's a bit of a debate. But,
right.
I hope to see someone Pulse that on Twitter and prove me right. But yeah, Perks in this mid lane. I mean, Perks is a cool name.
Pulse is super cool if you're like 12.
It is, and that's why
I named
my
nice name.
Yeah, it was good when I was 12, and then like, it got stuck with me.
Nice.
And then I could never show it. Well, HGK gonna push up the top lane here.
They will push the top lane.
They will. These are lane swaps, so they're just gonna take tower on top, take tower on bot.
But we have the situation where Infernal Drake is the first one,
yeah.
So it's actually really good for G2 to swap. Not only do the dodge around the 2v2 lane, that can be annoying. Also, Aurelia wants to get a few components towards Trinity Force before she really starts being impactful. And now you can technically, if you are G2, depending on how fast you're taking down this tower, just up straight into taking Infernal Drake. Like, you take tower, move into Infernal Drake, H3 cannot respond in time because you just saw them recall. You know the rough timings of when they will return to lane, but they're a little bit too slow on the side of G2, taking down his tower. So, no Infernal Drake for them. Instead, we will probably see standard lanes now. G2 will just return down to the bottom lane and then try and contest for the Drake and don't give it over for free.
Well, we have a completely even game right now, and G2, kind of what we were talking about in Champion Select, want to try and leverage their super strong lanes and try and get ahead, and we'll see if they can actually make that happen.
I think the first two picks with the Karma and Nidalee set up for the strong lanes, but when they saw the response from H2K were equally strong lanes, they moved away from it and added in more scaling.
Yeah.
First of all with Aurelia and there, first of all, and second of all with the Fizz mid lane as well, and actually went away from, okay, we need to win lane to win game. So I think that adaptation was smart, and that's why flex picking is so good.
Yeah.
We do see G2 send the bottom lane down. It's what we talked about before. You don't want to give away a free Infernal Drake because you're already also behind in the lane swap tempo. You don't really gain any advantage then. So we get the 2v2. As long as Expect can get to push out his lane and don't fall too far behind in CS and experience, it's fine. Mm-hmm. That's why Trick is on top side, kind of helping him, being there, making sure that in a 2v2, if it happens, he's ready to help. Because otherwise, it's an easy gank for someone like Jankos to show up. Oh, you're going to overextend level 3 or 4. Mm-hmm. Easy first blood, right? Instead, though, we get no outer turrets in side lanes, but standard lanes.
Yeah, really like the fact that HGK did respond with these stronger early picks, because it means Jankos is on like an Elise, something who does something early game, and Jankos is still the first blood king, even though sometimes he gives up first blood, but he's still involved in that first blood in some way.
It's a weird title.
It is.
Yeah, you give away the most, but you also take the most.
Well, we'll see. We'll see this time. Hopefully, he picks up the first blood himself. That would be preferable. Going for the early Lucidity booster. So.
Oh, I like it. I think CDR is the best you can get on Elise. Let's see what happens here, though, because early Infernal by H2K, but obviously with D2 being on bottom side, they're ready to contest it, and therefore everyone just backs away. No TP from Odo Omni. That's why H2K could not stay. They were trying to sneak it. Hoping because Freeze and Vander had the control on bottom side, TP though from Expect.
Freeze is going to net away, flash after Boomerang Blade does not connect, but here comes Expect, and he gets Cosmic Binded. There is a Spear coming in, but does not land, so good defensive play, only a Flash Burn coming in from Freeze, and that was also exchanged for Miffy's.
Yeah, so basically now G2 is forced to go Infernal Drake to gain something from the teleport, otherwise H2K will take it once Odo Omni has his TP ready. Didn't get any kills, wanted to go for the jackpot. Yep. Have to settle just for a much smaller price than getting some early kills, because Infernal Drake at 8 minutes is not that impactful.
Great later, though.
Great later, that's the key thing, right? But early on, you technically want more kills to get more gold. But you take it now if you're G2, you used your TP on it. Does put Expect a little bit behind for now, but the wave is pushing down towards him. If you look at your top side here, obviously Odo Omni is going to just hand over this massive wave.
Yeah.
And Expect can just catch up. So I actually like the play. I like when teams are very proactive when they have a TP advantage, even in the early game. Mm-hmm. Because H2K had that pushing bot side, but execution wasn't quite there, and Bard's power, when you have these walls to jump over with Magical Journey, showed itself.
Yeah, but it's still not too bad for G2, because as you mentioned yourself, they have more scaling on their side now, so they're going to be able to use the Fizz and the Aurelia when they get later into the game, and they'll be more than happy having an Infernal Dragon.
Definitely.
Ryu now pushing in the mid lane with Freeze, and the annoyance has begun as Caitlyn starts putting down traps, and folks find it harder and harder to back away. Now he's caught, but he actually just managed to sneak around that trap. Fizz is very small, and the Spider will land onto Miffy instead.
And this is a really good thing for H2K, because they had the pressure on bottom side and got to push the wave all the way to the tier 2 tower. Well, then you just move your AD carry early to mid, and Fizz doesn't have reliable wave clear when you're sieging the tower. And technically, D2 wants the Fizz then in side lanes and the Sivir in mid for wave clear, but it's way too early in the game for them to have swapped it until now to finally get a break. So I like this swap now from D2. They couldn't really do it before, and that's why H2K got some free tower on this mid tower. And again, I love watching these very small movements. I'm just like, it's all built around who pushes the lanes, technically, and who has the pressure in lanes. It's all that matters when it comes to rotating. You can never rotate first if you're constantly getting pushed back towards your own tower. Because like you need to stay and catch the wave. You don't want to give up free tower.
Exactly.
You don't want to lose experience and farm. You have to stay, and then the other team moves first. And that's what H2K did after having that bot lane push.
Falling further and further behind. So now Vander and Freeze, they're just farming up. So what are we looking in terms of how the lanes have gone so far? Slight advantage to Ryu. And slight advantage to Sven, so nothing massive to write home about just yet.
No, and now when you play this H2K comp, H2K plays a 1-4 composition where the Gragas is the one sitting in the side lane because he has teleport, not because he's a split pusher. The problem with your group of four is that you gotta assign them to the two other lanes, but they actually both want to sit in mid. No one really want to go to the side lane. Miffy has to be careful here. Perk's going all in as well.
He's trying to get the tether down onto Vander. Freeze did get hit by from the waters, but
too aggressive,
disengage.
On some of these early TPs. Odo Omni here could definitely have waited. Freeze had heal as well. And Perk's never really got to overcommit. He's actually just forcing a teleport and then he backs away.
Yeah.
But as I said before, Caitlyn is not very good in the side lane once the lane phase is over. She's very easy to kill. And she constantly needs support to sit right next to her. I mean, like, you can never leave, because if you leave, this Fizz will kill me, this Nidalee will come down and kill me, this Aurelia will come down and kill me. I need you here. That locks the support in place.
Yeah.
So you want to put Caitlyn mid, but you don't really want to move the Victor to side lane either. So it's very important for H2K that their group of three, which is their group with their AD carry support, so the group of two with the AD carry support, can push out the lane against the Fizz, and then move to the mid lane, so they join. So they're only separated for like a minute, then they push two lanes, and then they join together with Kate and Victor, so they never have to sit for a longer time alone in a side lane. And that's why the support, you can see Van on your minimap, is sitting right next to Freeze.
Yeah.
He wants to roam, he wants to put wards down with side control, but he can't.
Wouldn't it be harder and harder for HGK though, as like the game goes on? Because Expect has TP, Perks also has TP, and they're both playing great duelist champions, so it's very likely we'll see like the 1-3-1, right, coming in from G2.
100%.
So it'll be hard for HGK to really deal with that.
G2 is a perfect 1-3-1 composition with a wave clearing AD carry, sitting very early in the mid lane. Can even go static shift if you want on Sivir just to get even more wave clear. But it will be difficult for H2K, and that's why, you know, the comps are different things to do well. Like, H2K will be much better in, like, a grouped-up team fight.
Yeah.
When you have the Caitlyn, when you have the Victor, and we have a full tank Gragas. But G2, if they have the pressure on the map with the 1-3-1 and they get flanks, it's not a 5-on-5 then. It's like one guy fighting over here, one guy fighting over there, and it becomes like skirmish instead, even though it's 10 members.
Yeah.
And then G2's comp will do much better. So it's very clear strong points and weak points for both teams. HGK is all about being able to push out this lane with Freeze and Vander, even if they need to call in Jankos to be around them to make a three-man group, and then rotate in towards the mid lane with Ryo, or rotate in for Dragons slash Barons later.
See how that plays out. We're now 13 minutes into this game, and neither team has really interacted with each other just yet. I mean, we've had a lane swap, so probably why. Freeze is going to line up the shot onto Perks, and is going to be fine taking that damage. Perks also went for the early Negatron just so he could avoid some of the damage from Ryu. Meanwhile, Miffy will go into the bot lane as well. Lots of vision has come down the river, but you can see no real advantage. Next round's also going to be Infernal, so
good.
The teams might decide to try and do something on that
Miffy.
One. Tempered Fate onto Miffy.
He's window shopping.
Jankos and Odawam, they're coming in. Going to burn the flash, and he also ease away, so he's going to be safe now. But still burns the flash, but Jankos also flash as well. So that was an ultimate and flash for that.
In the end, honestly worth it for Miffy, because he's not going to be in the front line anyway on this Karma. He's sitting back with his team, providing the utility. But again, it's very important for HGK. They can always contest these dragons, because their comp wants to fight as a team. And if they ever get to the point where they just push back on every lane, then G2 will win straight away. Because if you have multiple losing lanes, there's nothing you can do in the map. So you need to always time it with dragons, pushing out your lane, move in to set up the dragon, and have a 5-on-5 team fight. If you lose that fight, well, then you lose the game, because your comp lost at what it was supposed to be the best at. And then you're just getting outplayed, obviously.
Let's see if that... because it looks like the teams are going to try and contest this. Both teams are contesting vision currently, and the dragon is now live.
And you can see how now HK got the bot lane pushing at first. Perks is still sitting there now pushing it back, but this allowed HK to now group. So now they're strong, now they're fine.
Yeah.
Now they get to get a bit of damage on tower. The reason Sven can't just walk up and clear the wave is because he has to respect multiple sorts of engages. Obviously as an AD carry. So you force him away from the minion wave. If a Sivir can always meet the wave in the middle, she just kills it instantly, you can never siege tower. If you force it back to tower, you get a bit of damage every time. And you get priority in moving into river, which is the key thing for H2K. But it took him quite some time.
Oh, Expect going in there. That was a barrel from Odawam, though. Yeah.
Not a good ulti from Odawam, and you can see Perks on bottom side now, just pushing in. So it basically took way too long for H2K to set this up, and they would have to surrender the Infernal Break. This is really bad for H2K. You're in a situation now where when you made a few moves after you pushed out a wave, you didn't first of all push it far enough, and you didn't even get the tower. Yes, it's low, but it's not dead yet. Two Infernal Drakes for G2 with a composition that has a fizz in the late game. HGK though has great scaling on their side. It's not like G2 is going to like automatically win the late game.
Yeah.
It's about winning the side lanes now for G2.
But G2 didn't really give up that much for those two dragons either. Like, they're ahead in gold, they're equal on towers, and now they just have two Infernals over H2K. It's not like the last series where we saw where Schalke got the two dragons but were behind in gold and giving up stuff for it. So G2 in a pretty good position so far in this game. Only 15 minutes in, next one's going to be Mountain. So actually lots of really good drakes today. I think we've seen one cloud. So the skies are not cloudy. We have good forecasts. And Miffy is kind of wandering around mid right now. Got lots of wave clearing going on. You can see just the disparity still opening up exactly the same as it was before. Top lane is equal. Freeze behind against Sven. Ryo ahead against Perks.
But these AD carry CS doesn't really matter too much in that case because they're both playing in different lanes at the moment. It obviously matters a lot because it sucks for the Caitlyn to be behind. Like, this is why some teams don't like Caitlyn that much anymore because she doesn't have a place with with a control mage, like Victor.
Oh, lots of damage coming in from Trick, but lots of return damage in from Ryu. And respect the ultimate, and Trick will jump away.
And just as to go back to the point from before here, where she doesn't have a place to be on the map with the Victor, because he's sitting mid, and she has to go side lane all the time. It's not great for freeze. Ryu!
Almost walked into it. And meanwhile, Yanko's going to try and punish Miffy. He's dropping very low. We'll get the snare down. Meanwhile, there's the explosive cast gone to Miffy, but there's no bleed. He will get away with his life for now. I think it's going to be the disengage. Good laser out from Ryu from very long range, so clears out the minion wave.
But because Ryu took so much damage and Trick just healed himself back to full HP, then HK had no mid laner. Couldn't contest any sort of fight. Rest of G2 with their two Infernal Drakes can just return to the side lanes. We know HK wants to group on this mid tower, that's why Expect is staying around. It's like, okay, we got TP on perks, we might get a TP flank here and stop HK from killing our tower. And also this wave on top is pushing away from him, so a bit of a rough spot for just a few more seconds. Yep. It's small things, again, like, okay, freeze down in CS, sucks for the Caitlyn, definitely. But he's not even been laning against the Sivir.
Yeah.
She's just been sitting mid, and this is a product of your composition. Crowd went nuts.
Over something. Ooh, big spear onto Vander. Lots of just poking, kind of trench warfare once again. This is kind of going back to traditional H2K games. Lots of game time, a lot of kills, a lot of objectives being contested more than anything. Poking in, chipping away, and then coming in with the win eventually after those rotations. Whereas G2, slowly clearing out the traps.
But it's so rough for them.
Yeah.
Because they have to just give perks a free lane. Because no one wants to commit to pushing it out. HK would have to use Yankos, Freeze, and Vanna together. All three men pushing up. That's actually what they're doing now. Push up this lane, all the way up to the tier 2 tower, and then rotate mid and take the mid tower. That's the play for H2K. But that's very predictable for G2, so you can see on your minimap, Mithy's already here. It's like, yeah, I know you're going to make a play on bottom side, so I'm already here hovering around, making it suddenly very risky for you guys to push it up. No Drake alive yet. It's all about getting that mid tower for the H2K and killing the Rift Scarlet.
Took it out. Destroyed.
So we see the push. Yanko's on bottom side. It's exactly what we talk about. Freeze and Vanna together. They need to push one more wave up if they want to rotate to mid and take the tower. But all of G2 is around. Even Expect is here. He's... Because they know the only play HK can make is push bot, take mid tower.
And yeah, it's just so predictable because Perks, he didn't even have that much vision in the enemy jungle, but it was just like, oh, the three people off the map, the three people who are probably going to deal with me, I guess I'll just walk back. And then immediately H2K, there's nothing for them to do anymore. So now the dragon being open 2 minutes, yes, they can fight over vision, but they're still going to need to do it later on over the next 2 minutes anyway. Baron's going to be spawning soon, but no team's really in a position to rush it down.
They just have to go for this mid tower now if you're H2K.
Yeah, they're going to try. It's the mid tower is very low, so instantly take it away. There's an ultimate coming in onto Sven. He's going to force the flash. And that will spell shield the ace in the hole. We'll bring back the storm as well. Trick is going to try and follow after. Land a spear maybe on the retreating members of H2K and just get the Luden's proc as well. But this is very much a slow early game. 20 minutes have gone by, still no kills. Who does this benefit more in the long run?
I mean, again, if we get team fights in the late game, you have Victor scaling, you have Caitlyn scaling, you have Gragas, who's just a full tank in the late game. So H2K definitely has a great late game team fight. But on the side of G2, we knew they had some of the lanes that wanted a little bit more time before they wanted to do anything. So for them, it was great they didn't fall behind in the early game. And then you just have two completely different compositions. Like one is a split pushing comp where no one can stop Fizz in the side lane. So that greatly benefits G2. If they keep playing this game, HK can't stop them. If they play a game where they have to rush in and like try and stop Barons or Sieges, then suddenly HK's comp can be strong. It's all about the execution of flanking from G2 on. But so far, with this even early game, the fact that two Infernals on the side of G2, they've definitely been winning out, and Fizz is just free farming. Yes, he's behind now, but no one is stopping him in this lane, and no one can stop him.
Yeah.
No one can stop him.
No one can really go down there, unless you commit three people, but we've already seen what happens in that scenario.
Yeah, rest of G2 just walks down with him.
Like, exactly.
You can bring out top laner.
Yep. It doesn't really matter, but H2K, they're trying to leverage the Caitlyn, but the middle tower's already gone, so there's nothing really to push there anymore. In fact, all of the outer turrets have gone down, so H2K, they don't really have anything to go for. The dragon is now up, so now they start looking to contest this vision.
And Freeze is only level 10 to level 12 of Sven, because right now he's only catching waves, and then he's also sharing experience with Ryu in mid, because this Caitlyn has nowhere to go. No one wants to be the man sitting inside me. No one is committing to it.
Because Perks is now pushing up the top lane.
Exactly. This Kate is super weak right now. She's in a weaker state in the mid game. Got zero advantage. G2 wants to fight here for sure.
Yeah, they have the TPs available on both of their split pushes, but Perks is still pushing away. So as long as H2K don't immediately take down this dragon, he will take that top tower. Look how fast
actually,
he's dropping, though.
Gonna take yeah. the tower.
It's just going to be, yeah, tower for dragon, and no one can stop him in time. So yes, that's the mountain dragon over to H2K, but now Perks, actually, does he have enough time? Because maybe. He'll get some damage on this tower at least. Meanwhile, the rest of his team is pushing in the mid lane. Here's the TP coming out, actually. There's a Tempered Fate. Stun onto two players. And the combo in from Ryu. They will drop Trick where he stands. Unexpected will start running away, but he's chased down by the ace in the hole. Meanwhile, Jankos is trying to find Miffy, but won't get him. 2-0 kills over to H2K.
I really would have preferred G2 to try and contest around the dragon when they had options to set up flanks as well.
Whoa.
Straight to Baron with one Mountain Drake on the side of H2K. 15 seconds for Trick, 18 for Expect with his teleport. Baron is going down.
It really is. I mean, Sven is trying to put some damage over the wall. There's Chum the Waters onto Ryu. Big damage coming in from Perks. He's going to have to jump away. Playful Trickster. H2K back onto the Baron. It's very low, and it is going to get dropped by Jankos. Meanwhile, Miffy actually just walked in and straight up died. Bottom end is low from H2K. Walked on top of a trap. Those are for Yordles.
Very, very quickly, we get some action. But it's a G2 team kind of not deciding on what they wanted to do, hovering around Dragon first. Being like, oh, this Kaden is level 10. Like, surely you can set up a fight here where your AD carry is already on two completed items, but then suddenly they don't feel like that proper positioning. And they change the call to say, okay, let's trade for towers. But this is a great ulti from Vanda setting this one up perfectly. Straight into tons of CC and damage from H2K. Odamin does a no-no on the Gragas where he hits first before he throws his ulti after the body slam. But in the end, they still get the kill and expect then straight to Baron. Like, this is H2K, five man together, great.
Yep.
But around that dragon, that could have been difficult for H2K to get a complete 5-on-5 because they would have been split to multiple sides. There were two ways for G2 to flank. So instead of fighting out in the open around that objective with multiple entrances, it actually became like G2 trying to group on a tower, and that gave H2K a perfect opportunity. Good ulti by Vander, great setup. Few kills, very impactful play though.
Yeah. It's really about these big landmarks that happen in games like this, where one team makes that mistake and then big capitalization by the other team really swings the game in their favor. You can do that right now. Baron Power Play, Baron Power Play will be pretty big, I have to feel, from H2K. Already taking that one tower up to 2,300, plus the Baron Gold. Good Soul Flare will clear out the mini wave alongside Sven. So that is something that G2 have, is a lot of wave clear. But H2K now pushing on two lanes, should easily be able to take down this inner turret as well.
Yeah, the wave clear is the Sivir. She's back in base at this point. Another tower for H2K. The 1-3-1 obviously falls apart when you lose a Baron and you can no longer push your side lanes. G2 just not committing, honestly, and not having the right call. Not sure if they were surprised about the engage from Vander on there, on the tower, and therefore gets punished for it. Because, like, you can see the idea behind it. Oh, we're pushing top, we're pushing mid, we get mid tower, then we rotate top, we take the top tower. Yeah, you get your Mountain Drake, we don't care, we get two towers for it. So I understand the call. Because of Vander, though, it completely backfired.
Yeah. I mean, you've got to pay attention to the tools that H2K have, right? But it's difficult when, obviously, Vanu was playing in fog at that point. So H2K pushing up the mid lane. Soul Flare will do a little bit of damage to Ryu. The continuous poke from Freeze is just difficult to play against for G2. I mean,
and the traps. You can't really get close enough. And because you have no pressure now in the side lanes, you can't really set up an easy flank. You have no wards right behind H2K, or you can't move from your lanes through the river and be like, oh, surprise, we're here. You're kind of just standing in front of them.
Yep.
It's a perfect little time here. Perfect few minutes for H2K.
So what do G2 need to do now? They need to regain control of their jungle, get those wards down, look for flank wards, and try and pincer H2K as they push up, or do they need to just split push with Perks?
Well, when you're G2, you want to go back to your 1-3-1. Yep. 100%. You need the Baron buff to expire. Obviously, H2K would just recall and kind of reset the map, so that's why you see Perks instantly trying to push out his lane. He needs to run away now, though. Should know the rest of H2K is coming. He's actually staying for now.
Well, now he sees Vander and Jankos and will immediately jump away. That's the flash burn. Tempered Fate comes in. Urchin Strike will be caught during the animation. And from here on out, it's not looking very good for Perks. Ooh, what a damage onto Vander and Jankos, but is not going to pick up the kill.
Shot calling from G2 is not the same this week. Perks had the right idea of, like, I need to go push out this wave to try and stop H2K from just grouping one more time because I need to have pressure in the side lane.
Yeah.
But he stayed for way too long, all alone, ends up going down. Another push for H2K. everything is just going wrong for G2, and it seems like no one really had a clear call right here as well, with Perks overstaying and dying. Always very hard for us to comment on the shot calling in game, but when you see something like that, you kind of like, well, that's a mistake we don't see often.
Yeah. Maybe it's even a product of what we were talking about pre-champion select, where expect now not kickers. So G2 maybe having to feed more information to him now, and expect needs to tell him what to do, and expect doesn't just do his own thing. Like, kickers knew exactly what to do. So integration time into the team, perhaps, because we've had very much a macro-orientated game. It's all been about the rotations, objectives, playing around the map, and maybe that really has hurt G2 in this game. H2K, they've just played an H2K game. They've played out slow, methodical, taken away the objectives when they needed to. Probably in contrast to what we saw last week, though. I think a lot of that was leveraged from Freezo just going ham on whatever AD carry is picking up on the day. Now, first picking the Caitlyn, the intent, I feel, was clear from the first pick.
Yeah, and definitely saved Freeze a lot to get 2 kills and 2 assists in that last fight. Because you, well, 2 and 1 assist because you got the kill or the last one on Perks in the end. But really saved him, because he was so far down in terms of gold, but also levels. He's still down in levels. Like, Sven is level 14 to level 12 on a Caitlyn. That's why G2 are finally saying, you know what, guys, we're actually strong enough to fight. Can set up any flank. We will get a fight, by the way.
Yeah, because G2 have already started the dragon. Jankos comes in. That will be secured by Trick. Meanwhile, Miffy is dropping so low. He'll be taken out 2-0. And Perks is unable to get inside that fight. Expect has also been called out. Crowdfield comes down. He's going to put some dodge back on towards Freeze, but it's really nothing. 3-0 plus the dragon.
And we talked about this, Pulse, how we want to see an H2K team with much better shot calling than G2, because they didn't have to make any changes. Yeah. And what we're seeing here is a G2 lineup technically at that point doing the right thing, trying to all in for that dragon and take a fight. But H2K just outplayed them completely.
Wow, 28 minutes into this game, and even though the dragon was secured by G2, they just lost so many members. Perks gonna jump in again, instantly blown up, playful trickster away. Miffy is trying to keep him alive, but he'll go back to the fountain as well. That's the first Nexus turret going down.
No minions, except for that one little guy who's gonna get killed by the tower, meaning H2K needs to run away. Spiderlings decides to soak up all the crits.
Yep. And now HGK will back away, but they dealt so much damage to G2's base in that. And everyone will turn into a penguin and take the magical journey out, but Expect is behind them looking for a flank. Transcendent Blade is going to keep poking them down. He's getting a lot of value out of this ultimate. Trick following after. They got Sven and Miffy speed boost. Fantastic ultimate by Oduwamne to open up the fight. Expect comes in, gets the shut down onto Caitlyn. Oduwamne backing away, but the Critter Jay is doing work. Vanza should be able to get out of here, but Oduwamne not going to be so lucky. Expect finds him. Blade Surge. And Miffy will try and finalize the final kill.
He wants to snipe him. Support.
Combat.
You can do it, Miffy.
Comes in. There's the Inspire.
No,
but Vanda, he's away.
Ah, the minion wave as well. Vanda gets to run away. For now, Sven.
Jankos in this duel, but this is a 2-1. Repel comes up, but he's got nowhere to go. And Expect will take him out. Equilibrium strike.
So finally, G2 gets a messy fight where it's very split up. Rest of H2K invested so much to try and finish the game. One Nexus turret still alive. Baron is up. G2 is starting it. 3 Infernal Drakes, guys. They have so much extra damage. The jungler is coming though with the smite. Right now, Ryu is here, and Aura has a good ult.
Oh man, look how low G2 are. Expect is kind of locked in the Baron right now. He's going to get the shield from Miffy. That was a little close. Now they'll back away. But HGK have control over the area now.
And it was a G2 lineup knowing, okay, we're behind. Our composition can't really do that well in these teamfights where H2K can always see us and we can't really flank them, so we need to do something crazy. That was obviously trying to get the kills, and then a Baron after, sadly for them, took too much damage, and also the last turret went down to the super minions. This game just exploded.
It really did, and quite literally an open mid now for G2. Nothing defending it anymore. In H2K, the Baron has spawned. The next dragon will be Mountain as well. But those triple Infernals, need to see if G2 can use all that extra damage they have.
Yeah, we sadly didn't get to see a replay of that dragon fight. Sven died with Flash and everything ready. Oduwamne just went straight for him and killed him, meaning G2 could never fight. It was just over too quick. Great engages so far in this game from Oduwamne. We've seen a few missed ultis here and there, but also seen some very good ones.
Yeah. HGK, they're dancing around the Baron area right now, just trying to pull G2 out. and get them into a negative situation. Perks is, again, split pushing off to the side, does not have the TP right now.
No, and it's so hard at this point in the game to set up 1-3-1 because you have already lost so much on the map. You have no control in mid lane. That means you can never push your side lanes.
Yeah, especially without TP.
Yeah, exactly. Like, all lanes work together. If two of them are being pushed back, well, then your third guy, he can't push. I know he's trying. I know he's playing Tryndamere. He wants to be the guy to win the game for it, but it doesn't work. So G2 now have to basically try and outplay in a fight. Have to try and maybe catch one member from H2K out, but it's super difficult because H2K will never try like 1v1ing anyone. They want to win as five, but triple Infernal gives you so much extra damage. 31 minutes in and they're starting Baron.
Yeah, G2 are moving on to the Baron. There's a Tempered Fate, lands onto Perks once again. Can he get out here? Does have the play for Trickster, but he's instantly locked up by Bard. And there's no way he's going to get out of this one. So many resources used on top of him. Odo Arme over the wall. Probably misclick onto the portal there.
Van in this game, we said, if you're a great Bard, he's fantastic. If you have a bad day or you're maybe not the strongest Bard player, he's going to be bad. Van has played extremely well. So many good ultis. Definitely my player of the game.
I concur.
100% kill participation as well.
I like how you paused for the maps there.
Yeah, I was like, 9 plus 1, I'm pretty sure.
10. Got it. But H2K, with that one kill, 20 seconds left on Perks, the rushing down the mid lane. There's no Nexus turret. Xbeck goes in for the engage, but there's an instant exhaust out onto him. Miffy will try and put some damage down, but he doesn't have a lot. Sven is going to get cornered out. Trick as well comes in. Everyone from H2K is very low, and they are getting danced around by Miffy and Trick. They jump into the fight, but are instantly detonated. Perks will respawn, but now the Nexus has been opened up. Perks, time to shine. Can he make it happen? Locked up by Bard and taken out before he gets out of the CC chain. That is going to be the game. 33 minutes in, H2K, take it away.
Very slow start. Focus on macro, lane control, setting up for dragons, split push versus team fighting. Freeze was in such a tough spot because he had to be the guy going to the side lane all the time and just trying to push out like one or two waves, then he had to leave to always roam.
Yep.
Two levels down, and then G2 had to make a decision. Do we fight for this third dragon? We try and trade it for towers. I think both calls made sense. But then Vander with the ulti catches two members of G2, wins that fight instantly, takes the Baron at 22 minutes, and then your split pushing comp is done. It's dead. Because you now literally lost the map from that one play from H2K. And then you gotta go back always being like, okay, should G2 have flashed out that bottle? Because I'm pretty sure if people go back and rewatch, there were flashes ready. For the members who got caught, you could have flashed out trying to disengage. That's always hindsight. In the moment, they're clearly calling. Take mid tower, rotate top with Perks, take top tower, trade it for the dragon. Even though they had actually a situation where the AD carry was so much stronger.
Yeah.
Like, Freeze was useless at that point. But then he picked up a few kills.
Which obviously helped. I hope you guys can also hear the music that I can right now, because that was the most epic monologue I've ever heard in my life as Zificio. Just talking away, and I got the victory music coming out. Fantastic. But no, it was really just all around that play that we saw around like what the 20-minute mark. We didn't have a lot going on. We had actually no kills. And then it was just a push in mid lane, a push in top lane. And of course, they got punished by Evander. So well played with the reaction play from H2K, but it felt like the onus, of course, was on G2 to try and make something happen. They didn't pull the trigger on the dragon. Then they were pushing in these lanes. They were trying to have their cake and eat it too, right? But then H2K, they just need to scale into the late game. So yeah, big problems there. Either way, we're going to send it over to the analyst desk to take a look at the game and get their opinions.
Thank you very much, Pulse. And wow, H2K in these matches of the week, last week versus Fnatic, and now already a very convincing 1-0 over G2. And it was kind of a different style. It was more H2K-esque, I dare say, very, very clinical game.
Yeah, so so slow as well at the beginning. We had the lane swap go through, and then for like 15 to 20 minutes, almost nothing, just fairly passive. A couple of sequences where you could see expect push up and get punished, and there were small little advantages that were gained by Odo Amne in the top lane, but generally G2 had a very small advantage for the majority of that game, and we were sat here thinking, okay, well, I guess expect is going to start to take over a little bit on the split push game, but nobody really was anticipating that 22-minute Vander play with the Bard ult.
Let's take a look at it. Yeah,
because this honestly just exploded the game. From what was a very slow game, turns instantly into H2K going all systems go, and you know, Vander gets the lockdown there as well after it. Odo Amne with the TP in. And this is just the perfect setup that they needed to be able to take their first Baron and from there take control of the game.
Yeah, it certainly was. After the Baron, they pretty much had their firm foot in the game, and they were not even going to remotely let go of that opportunity. So they are able to get another pick off the back of this Baron, which really just solidifies their lead even further. But the really big thing to bear in mind about this whole game is Perks never really had an opportunity to run away with the game on the Fizz. You could see that he tried desperately many times to try and force these fights and get onto the back line, but it was just so difficult for him to have any real impact on this Fizz. And if we just look back at week one, where he got one kill in the early game against OG and just snowballed like crazy, he has not had any opportunity. H2K saw that, they played around it perfectly, and they get a very clean game overall.
Am I correct in saying that Expect or Kiki's in that top lane for this game, it wouldn't have made a difference, or is there anything that you can read off that?
I mean, I'll be honest, I felt the same way last week's games as well. I didn't think that there was a massive positive bonus when Expect came on to what Kikis was bringing, and as we were talking about pregame, it's a short-term hit on the communication, and if they can get that to a good level for G2, that it'll improve. But honestly, right now, I don't see that there's any particular difference in a positive way for G2.
Yeah, possibly, of course, the communication, but we can't hear their comms, so we don't know what is going wrong or what they're working on there. However, of course, only game one of the series. G2 can bounce back, but I am very impressed with H2K over the course of last week, that 4-0, and now how they play this game. Ryu stepping up a lot more as well.
Yeah, he certainly was. The overall team play was just really impressive. Week one, H2K looked a little bit shaky, but from week to week, they have been growing very quickly as a team, and we can see the difference that Freeze and what other people have been talking about that he brings to the team, and how they just seem to have a more positive atmosphere, and how they just seem to be playing better.
Freeze and Vander gelling in that bottom lane. Vander is also our player of the game in this one. Martin almost coerced us into doing it. I think this is my player of the game, 100%. But we did agree. A good Bard can influence your entire game.
Good Bard. Last week we saw some Zyra come out from him as well. Vander finding his groove in the regular split. And I want to see the Zyra again. Last week he was like third highest damage in the game. Like out damaging AD carries. So Vander, when he's on form like that, that's what we like to see from Vander, from Jankos, is that aggression, the good plays that we see out of H2K.
So H2K taking that number one game, and while they regroup for game two, we're also going to check in on Vitality versus the UOL over in the LCS arena. Vettius, you've been keeping an eye on this game.
I have indeed, and if you haven't already noticed, there was an Illaoi, a Jhin, and a Zyra all locked in on the same team for UOL. To some people, that might not be much of a surprise, but for UOL, they have certainly been struggling to make it work. When you have that Illaoi-Zyra combo, it's a little bit easier and a little bit more reliable to get the damage down, but Vitality have been playing around it beautifully, and up until recently, it's just been a lot of picks back and forth trades here and there, and the big interesting trade was between Vizichachi and Cabo, where Chachi actually gets the solo kill down onto Cabo, but there was one big team fight earlier that has currently given Vitality the big kill lead, but not quite the gold lead.
Yeah, not quite for now, but you got to look at this this composition UOL are trying to run with the Zyra, that kind of thing. Up against Vitality, they've got good ways of either engaging or disengaging. The Ashe, the Gragas, the Karma, it makes it very difficult for Zyra to actually get the good ultimates down if you're not being engaged upon, and that's what's forced Hilly time and time again to be caught out, unfortunately. 0-5 on that Zyra right now, not looking so hot.
No, not the greatest game for him. You can catch the end of that Vitality UOL game on stream EULCS1, but with the series here on EULCS2 at 1-0 in favor of H2K, it is time for a quick cooldown. Stay right there. Game 2 is coming your way in just 3.5.